All right, everybody, welcome back. In this episode, we're going to take Isaiah chapter 60. We're going to see the glory of Israel and the kingdom of God. All right, we'll take verses 1 through 3, then review. Verse 1, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising." So after the thick and desperate darkness that's described in Isaiah chapter 59, verses 9 and 10, this is the glorious rescue from the Redeemer. Light has come, so God tells his people to respond to it and arise and shine. And darkness is for lying down, light is for rising up. Darkness is for gloom and sleep, light is for shining. So first we receive God's light, and then we have a service to perform. And you can't shine until your light has come, but once it's come, there's something wrong if you don't arise and shine. And there we see in these passages that this is no earthly light. It's a light that emanates from the glory of the Lord. And this is like the light of Jesus in the Transfiguration, when his face shone like the sun and his clothes became white as the light in Matthew 17, verse 2. Sometimes harsh, bright light can be disturbing or uncomfortable, but not this very warm and wonderful light that pulsates from the glory of the Lord. And so when the Lord lifts up his glorious light over Israel, the Gentile nation shall see it and be attracted to the light. Even kings will be attracted to the brightness of Israel's rising. And this is going to be ultimately fulfilled in the millennial kingdom of Jesus when Israel is lifted up among all the nations. While in principle this chapter has application to all of God's people, it is specifically directed to Israel, and it will be fulfilled in the millennial kingdom. Okay? And not all have seen this. So Adam Clark said about this, "The subject of this chapter is the great increase and flourishing state of the Church of God by the conversion and accession of the heathen nations to it. But, key word, the fact that the Lord speaks of the Gentiles here in opposition to the subjects of the prophecy shows that he speaks to Israel as Israel. Replacement theology doesn't work here or anywhere else in Scripture." All right, verse 4 through 13. "Great treasures come to Israel in the kingdom." Verse 4. "Lift up your eyes all around and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your son shall come from afar, and your daughter shall be nursed at your side. Then you shall see and become radiant, and your heart shall swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the Gentiles shall come to you. The multitude of camels shall cover your land, the dromedaries of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come, and they shall bring golden incense, and they shall proclaim the praises of the Lord. All the flocks of Kedar shall be gathered together to you. The rams of Nobath shall minister to you. They shall ascend with acceptance of my altar, and I will glorify the house of my glory. Who are these who fly like a cloud and like doves to their roosts? Surely the coastland shall wait for me, and the ships of Tarshish will come first, to bring your sons from afar, their silver and their gold with them, to the name of the Lord your God, and to the Holy One of Israel. Because he has glorified you, the sons of foreigners shall build up your walls, and their kings shall minister to you. For in my wrath I struck you, but in my favor I have had mercy on you. Therefore your gates shall be open continually. They shall not be shut day or night, that men may bring you the wealth of the Gentiles and their kings in procession. For the nation and kingdom which will not serve you shall perish, and those nations shall be utterly ruined. The glory of Lebanon shall come to you, the cypress, the pine, the box tree together, to beautify the place of my sanctuary, and I will make the place of my feet glorious." So through this passage, one of the great themes is regathering. We may suppose that in the millennial kingdom of Jesus, every Jewish person remaining on the earth will be gathered into the land of Israel from every nation on earth. The present day regathering of Israel is a precious preview of this ultimate and complete regathering. And not only will they receive the treasure of their people, but this is the literal treasure of the Gentiles that will come to Israel in the millennial kingdom. The nations will willingly give them their wealth, much as the Egyptians willingly gave the Israelites riches when they left Egypt in Exodus chapter 12, verses 35 to 36. So much will be given that they will need to keep the gates of the city open continually. And so why do the nations bestow these riches on little Israel? Well, first, they're going to recognize that they're giving it to God. And second, they're going to do it because they see the work of God in Israel. And so they're going to willingly give to and serve Israel. And so another reason the riches of the nations pour into Jerusalem in the millennial kingdom of Jesus will be to build and support the millennial temple. The millennial temple, which is described in great depths in Ezekiel chapter 40 to 47, and we'll cover that in detail when we take up Ezekiel, stands as a place memorializing God's presence and work in history. And there will apparently be priests and sacrifices at the temple, but not for atonement, because atonement was finished at the cross. The sacrifices are for worship, consecration, and perhaps historical reenactment. All right, verses 14 through 18, how the nations treated Israel and how they're going to treat them in the kingdom. Verse 14, also the sons of those who afflicted you shall come bowing to you, and all those who despised you shall fall prostrate at the soles of your feet, and they shall call you the city of the Lord, Zion of the Holy One of Israel, whereas you have been forsaken and hated, so that no one went through you. I will make you an eternal excellence, a joy of many generations. You shall drink the milk of the Gentiles, and milk the breast of kings. And shall know that I, the Lord, am your Savior and your Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. Instead of bronze, I'll bring gold. Instead of iron, I'll bring silver. Instead of wood, bronze. And instead of stones, iron. And I will make your officers peace, and your magistrates righteousness. Violence shall no longer be heard in your land, neither wasting nor destruction within your borders. But you shall call your walls salvation, and your gates praise. So those who previously persecuted Israel, and specifically Jerusalem, will have a very different heart and mind in the millennial kingdom. They're going to come bowing down to Jerusalem, and they're going to recognize it as the city of the Lord. And God's going to take what's old, and he's going to replace it with far better things. More of a miracle than turning bronze to gold is turning magistrates to righteousness. And so we get a glorious transformation here. We go from violence and unrestrained bloodshed in chapter 59 of Isaiah to walls called salvation and gates called praise. And so the ultimate fulfillment of these things is in the millennial kingdom. It's not yet here, but the king of that kingdom is here, and he wants to do some of that work on a different level. For example, a home can see a beautiful transformation right now. It can be said of a Christian home that violence shall no longer be heard in your home, neither wasting nor destruction within your walls, but you shall call your walls salvation and your doors praise. Okay? And this will explain why God will do all this. It's not because Israel is so great and has earned this as a high achievement through hard work. He does it so that we know that God is our Lord and Savior and Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. Verses 19 through 22, how the Lord is going to treat Israel in the kingdom. The sun shall no longer be your light by day, nor by brightness shall the moon give light to you. But the Lord will be to you an everlasting light, and your God your glory. Your sun shall no longer go down, nor shall your moon withdraw itself. For the Lord will be your everlasting light, and the days of your mourning shall be ended. Also your people shall all be righteous. They shall inherit the land forever. The branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified. A little one shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. I, the Lord, will hasten it in its time. So this is like the light of the new Jerusalem described in Revelation 21, verse 23, where the Lord himself is a light. But just as important as having the Lord on your, you know, as your everlasting light, is having your God as your glory, and to glory in nobody or anything else. And so when we remember the context of Isaiah's prophecy, it makes it even more precious. Isaiah was written under the shadow of coming defeat and exile. And so he's pointing to a day that they're going to inherit the land forever. And God didn't say that it was going to happen soon, though in an eternal scale, we could consider it very soon. But God would hasten it. He would hurry it along, expedite it in its time. So when its time has come, the Lord will hasten it, but not before its time. Okay? And that's chapter 60. Thank you for joining me.